No, when you're going down Bristry,
right?
You turn right into Gardner Street.
Right.
Then you turn right again where the United Berlin, United
right.
There you see the net bank.
Yes.
The German club place.
Yes. There is.
That in the German club place.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
By 7 o'clock.
Inshallah.
So when you get something from the Prophet, Alhamdulillah, the Inshallah, the Rishuka, whatever.
Ji, aap kuch hai.
So, your father, he says chop off a hand. What do you say to that? Your father, your mother saved your father's life. And now your father got inspiration. What do you tell your father? What are you going to tell your father? Tell him, tumhara kuch kis gaya hai kya? You know, we've been taking some drugs. Tell me, told my mother, but I said, you know, she's serving you. You know, she saved your life and, you know, chop her hands. Say, yes, I'm inspired. So what the hell are you talking about? So, no, beta, you know, khuda ke taraf se hamare upar hukam hua. Baba jaan, kuch shaitan tum par galib aa gaya. Some bloody devil has said, you know, done this to you. Your father is not right in his head. If you say, God said there's such a thing, you say, look, then that God is not right in his head. The woman who saved your life, you chop off her hands? He said, look, now you're talking to the Christian. He said, look, this is what your book says. What? Impossible. You've got the Bible there. If he comes with the Bible, he said, look, bring your Bible. You open up Deuteronomy, 5th book of Moses, chapter 25, verse 11. Par. Read it loud.
The two men fight together and the wife of one draws near to rescue her husband. From the hand of the one attacking him and puts out her hand and seizes him by the genitals. Then you shall cut off her hand, your eye shall not pity her.
Rahmat kha uske upar, uska haath kaat dalo. Can God give you such an advice? For saving your father's life, the only means she had, she thought of, was, man, she's too filled with anything. And that's a weak link of man, any man. No matter what a bloody giant he is. He's got him, and the husband gets up, gives him a couple of blows, throws him out of the house, locks the door, saved his life. So that's a chop of her hands. God talking that. Is the word of God? The foreign, you know, the guy says, no, man, he made a crack. If this is that, then you carry on. Baap betiyo ke saath sala khilwat karta hai. You know, bete maa ke saath sala khilwat karta hai. You know, bhai behen ko rape karta hai. Then one of the sons of Dawud alayhi salam, wholesale, he had sex with 10 of his father's wives. Wholesale, one time, one by one, vroom. In this book. But with this shit, the guy's getting customers. And you and I can't get customers with the Quran. Reason.
We're not so equipped like they are.
No. We're not talking. You'll get equipped. As soon as you start opening your mouth, you'll find the guy made a fool of you. Now you're going to look for an answer. Take a Siddiqui bhai salabu yasa sa kehta tha. Take a nahi, you know, Farooq, you know, this is how you should have answered. Or you come and ask me to do that, or somebody. That answer you're going to retain. Because you're searching for an answer and you got it. And you're searching for an answer, you get it. So your knowledge increases.
Right.
The only way is you open your mouth. Just talk, man, any bloody thing. If you don't know anything, what about hygiene? Our Muslim hygiene. That, you know, when we go for number one, we wash. When we go for number two, we wash. As a young man, if I have an nocturnal emission, I have a complete bath from head to toe. Otherwise, I don't go to the mosque, I don't read the Quran. As a married man, every time I cohabit with my wife, I have a complete bath from head to toe. Otherwise, I don't go to the mosque. Our hygiene, man, is the topmost hygiene in the world.
Right.
Talk about it. But not some just talk, man. Our Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, deliver the message regarding me, even if it is one verse. That's all. Even if you know one verse, talk, man. And that's the secret of knowledge. Allah will fill you up with more. Nasiruddin bhai, you are from Karachi?
Ji, janab.
Kaun si jagah Karachi?
Gulshan-e-Aqbal mein
rehta hoon. Yes.
آپ کئی مرتبہ پاکستان آئے میں نے سنا اخبار میں پڑھا آپ کا انٹرویو بھی پڑھا میں نے تکبیر میں ہی میں نے پڑھا تھا آپ کا انٹرویو لیکن بس اتفاق نہیں ہوا تھا میں یہ شبیر بھائی سے کہہ رہا تھا کہ آپ سے ملائیں یہ مجھے جگہ تو معلوم نہیں میں دربن دو میرا خیال ہے کوئی 50-60 مرتبہ آیا ہوں لیکن یہاں آنے کا کوئی فائدہ نہیں تھا اس لیے کہ نہ ہمارے مطلب کوئی جاننے والے تھے نہ کھانے کا مذاق ہے نہ کوئی اور چیز خریدنے والی ہے یہاں اسپیشلی کبھی باہر نہیں آتے تھے یہ تو لکیلی دسمبر میں ان سے ملاقات ہو گئی لاسٹ دسمبر میں
Yeah, you're from Durban?
Jee.
Why I thought you come from the ship as well?
No. I'm from Durban. We have a couple of shops at the harbour area.
All right.
We used to, used to come to our place in Brickfield Road, Amusements, next door to Sterling.
Right.
Hassan is my dad.
Yes.
Right, so we got a few ships there. But what I have noticed is we Muslims have lacked these things that the Christians have been excelling in when they get
Correct.
Ships.
Very good.
The Christian missionaries are there, they go out of their way. And even in my own way, okay, I don't want to talk about what we do, you know. Even we get Muslim seamen coming wanting to go to the mosque on a Friday. We can't provide that thing, you know, that is really very pitiful.
We are not organized in anything.
Yes. You know, I've tried, I've even spoken to Shafat. I've spoken to Shafat and Yusuf. Buckers once.
Right.
I said, listen, I'm prepared to, you know, go in whichever way we can.
Right.
You know, let us set up something. Then I finally contacted Shafat.
Right.
And he's doing the same
he's
as
doing
I
something.
Was.
He's doing
so
something.
He told me, offered me position. I said, I'm not interested in position.
Right.
No, I'm not interested in that thing.
Right.
Whatever you need, kumbi, I've got a kumbi.
Right.
Get a driver.
Right.
I'm a businessman. I've got 4 businesses. I haven't got the time. But I am prepared to.
Right.
Yes, the facility.
Right.
Find somebody. This is your job. You're at it.
Right.
Let's get it done. It never seemed to have taken off.
Yes. You see, because now the Christian, he is motivated.
Yes.
By his priests.
Right.
Our alims are not telling you that.
Mm.
That's the real reason.
Yes.
If the Ali was telling you from a member, I'm telling you. I said, this is my business. All this I'm talking to you people, this is my business.
Right.
At the back of your mind, you discount me. So that's his livelihood. That's his livelihood. But if the Imam told you that, okay, bhai, you know, Allah will question you on the day of judgment, did you deliver the message to the guy working for you?
Mm.
He says, no. So why not?
I give all my work as some of this. Shafat has brought a number of this. I've distributed it to them.
You're going to say I was too busy. Sir. You were
that
too
is,
busy to
I,
do my
I,
job.
I'm feeling ashamed to tell you that I haven't got the time to do that.
But at least you see, you're making a reason. You'll be confessing that this is my problem, here, but here's the kumbi.
Yes.
Here's the key, the petrol is inside.
Yes.
Salah
yes.
School, use kumbi.
Right, no problem.
So that means you are making the positive gesture.
Mm.
But now, if it came from the member, we will be activated. But the guy from the member, he will never tell you that.
Even Ramzan time, we get a lot of this kind of problem where you get Muslims working on cruise ship, they don't have halal food to make seri and iftar. We accommodate them in whichever little way we can. But you know, but then again, how much can I do?
Right. There's a limit. There was a time when I should run around, but now how much can I run?
Yes.
ये जो आपने marking की है
ये
कोई book भी नहीं आपने ऐसी निकाली
हाँ ये combat kit में से
अच्छा
you take few copies
अच्छा yes
take extra copies and you take 2 sets of all literature tell me you own 2 sets
yeah.
So when you want to give to the printer suppose you want to reproduce
yeah.
It's easier to get the
آپ کا زیادہ ٹائم نہیں لیں گے بہت بہت شکریہ سب بہت بہت شکریہ آپ ہمارے لیے دعا کیجیے گا ہم بہت گنہ گار
ہیں
تو یہ 2 جولائی کو
رائٹ انشاءاللہ
یو ول بی موسٹ
ویلکم آن دی شپ نو نو انشاءاللہ
بڑی خوشی
نو یو گیٹ یور گائز 2 گھنٹے کا کام ہے
سیکرٹ
واز اونلی 2 آورز
جی
No. Oh no, the Reddy fellow who wanted to contact you about the Bible or something.
Oh.
I told him to get it from
the Bible house.
Bible house, yeah. Anyway.
Pleasure. Anyway. Welcome, welcome.
This is Kendall Smith.
Welcome.
Good morning, Mr. Deedat.
Please, please.
Thank you.
Come, sit down.
Thanks.
Get you some tea, coffee, Coke?
I'd love a cup of tea, please.
With milk, without milk?
Without milk, thank you.
Yourself?
No, thanks.
Well, Salaam. One tea with milk, without milk. Out of heavy, that's it. Eat milk, just one.
Yeah, so I'll see him on Saturday and, you know, I'll give you a round.
And ask him, and obviously it's very difficult for me to not to know when I'm intruding and when I'm not.
Indeed,
intruding,
yeah.
Because he's a very busy man with his practice.
Was I told Mrs. Campbell Smith?
That's right. It's a very long name, unfortunately, but my husband's not.
Double barrel.
Double barrel.
So at one stage, the husband and the wife must have been both persistent about his, I want my surname, and that is also my surname. You know?
No, so, no, I haven't been like that. That is just my husband's name, but it's a very long name.
No, I mean his family.
That's right.
Campbell Smith.
Campbell Smith, yes.
Right. So the Campbell and the Smiths, they must have it.
I think they must have amalgamated together. It's a Scots family and an English family.
Oh,
you see. So I think that way back in the days when the Scots and the English were still fighting each other, they obviously joined, and that's how it happened.
Yes, you're welcome, ma'am.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you for sparing me the time. I've come to see you today basically to tell you a little bit about my company.
Right.
I thought that I could start off first of all by giving you my card.
Right.
So that you know who I am.
Yes.
My telephone number and address are on the back of the card.
Right, right.
Because I don't know, for some strange reason they decided that was the way to do things.
That's all right. Yes.
And my husband was quite interested to know that I was coming to see you.
He would have joined you, you know.
He works in Botswana, actually.
Oh.
But previously he has been working in Saudi Arabia.
Right.
In Dahan.
Right, right.
So he said to please send you his best wishes.
Thank you.
And,
you would have said the salams to.
That's right. So he's done a lot of work. He's been working there for almost 2 years,
right,
in Saudi Arabia.
Right, right.
He used to come home every couple of months to see us.
In Durban? In Durban?
First of all, in England, because I've been living in England for the past 16 years.
Right, right,
and,
right.
We decided that perhaps we would try and be a little closer as a family.
Right.
But now he's working in Botswana. And I'm working here, so really, it hasn't helped. It would have made no difference.
Yes.
He spends as much time traveling now as he did before.
Sí.
The company that I am with, Mr. Deedat, is called Mondial.
Yes.
It is part of a company called Hansard International Trust.
Yes.
Which is one of the largest international brokerages in the world.
Right.
We have our main headquarters in the Isle of Man.
Yes.
Which, as you know, is an island of England. The reason that we have that is that we find that we provide more of a tax advantage for people who have money abroad.
Right.
And also, in the Isle of Man, you can use whatever currency you wish.
Right.
Whereas if you have investments in England, you have to use sterling,
right,
etc. Right,
et cetera. Right, right.
The company
is.
Thank you very much. The company itself was started in July 1970.
Yes.
The company was started basically because we found that we could provide better service to people if we actually lived within the country that they were operating.
Right.
Which is why my husband was living and working in Saudi Arabia.
Right.
Because if you have money and investments overseas, it's very hard to know what is going on in that country,
right,
and what is the best thing that you should do.
Right.
If you only have somebody perhaps coming to see you once every 6 months,
yes,
or perhaps once a year,
mm-hmm,
if you're lucky.
Yes.
So we found that it was much better to actually live and work in the countries where people were actually living and working, so that we could advise them on an everyday basis, that we could be there if they needed service. Up to this point of time, we have now, since July 1970, within Mondial, have on hand over £500 million of our clients' funds. Those are invested with various organizations. You've had a lot of problems in South Africa with companies like Master Bond and Supreme Bond, and basically people that are not very honest. Within the Isle of Man, which is run by the Manx government, they say, first of all, that whatever financial company that is actually operating on their island, they first investigate. And if you have, for example, like we have, £500 million invested throughout the world, you have to put up security of the same amount. Then each of these companies has to pay to the government basically what is a fidelity, so that if anything happens to your company, then the people that have invested with you, their government guarantees you 90% of your investment at the time of the company's collapse. Because they believe that if you are going to have people investing with you, you must have a certain morality. So that is why we find that a lot of people invest through us, because of this guarantee. And I sleep well at nights because I know that no matter what happens, those people's monies are guaranteed, which I think is very important. The other thing that we also do is, first of all, look at the tax efficiency of all investments. Because it's fine if you go to a stockbroker and he says, invest in RBI, Hong Kong, Shanghai Bank, whichever. And he invests your money. And then he says to you, Mr. Deedat, now it's time to sell. And you do. And you make money. And then you turn to your stockbroker and say, but what about my tax situation? And he says, Mr. Deedat, now you must go to an accountant. We don't find that there is point in that. There is no good you making a 40% profit and having to pay 30% in tax. So we would rather put you in a position where you made a 14% profit and legally paid no tax at all. That way, you not only actually have a good return on your money, but you know that you do not have to not only pay the stockbroker and the accountant and the tax. It's a crazy system.
But isn't it against the law for a South African to keep money outside?
It is not against the law for a South African to keep money outside, Mr. Deedat, if he declares it to the Reserve Bank. And don't forget that I am not just dealing with South Africans. I am dealing mainly with either English expatriates or overseas residents, English people who have lived here, or Americans, Chinese, or whoever. That is not against the law to have money abroad. You have to declare what you have abroad to the Reserve Bank, and you have to, by law, bring your dividend into this country. But it is not illegal to have money externally, as long as it is declared. I obviously can't be held responsible for people's morals, I cannot investigate whether they declare it or not. But my advice to people, there's no good having money in a bank that is actually depreciating. Because whatever country you live in, whether it's here, or the Middle East, or England, the cost of living is going up, doubling here in Africa every 5 years, doubling in Europe every 10 years. So if you put 10,000 rand and said, I'm going to be fine for the next 5 years, you will not be. Because the money that you actually put in the bank will not be worth 10,000 in the next 5 years. It won't even be worth a third. So what we're saying to everybody is, please, let's look towards your retirement. Let's look to where you are now. Because why, after working all your life, Must you, because of investments or non-investments, have to live your retirement age in poverty? Because you didn't do any planning. There's more and more people who do not plan for when they get older. They think that old age will never happen to them.
It will look after itself.
That's right. It will look after itself. That is fine. But the Lord always says, I will help you who help themselves first. So, having given me that, there are so many also women who perhaps are widowed, who have been left life assurance by their husbands, who do not know what is the best way to plan for their future and their children's future. And I think that with careful advice, they can actually do this planning. I'm quite happy with whatever I do, whatever proposal I put to whoever the person is. I'm happy that they take it for a second or third opinion. They can take it to an accountant or a trusted friend who has perhaps investment and legal knowledge for another opinion. I'm quite happy. But all I'm saying is, don't sit like an ostrich and pretend that tomorrow is not going to happen. Let us look at what it is today and let us plan for our futures. That is basically what I do. But I don't deal a lot with South Africans because few South Africans have money abroad. I deal basically with businessmen who perhaps are doing business abroad and who get paid abroad. And obviously need to look at their method of what they do with their monies.
Coming out is true. You know.
Our business is religion.
Yes.
We have been guiding tourists to the mosque since we started. It actually started that around the 50s, 60s. We reached a stage where we were organizing lectures on a big scale, like the city halls of Durban, Johannesburg, Cape Town, on comparative religion. And the government clamped down, not particularly on us, but upon all blacks, said we can't have the city halls because that falls under white area. And we need a permit for that. So all the city halls were out of bounds all of a sudden. Not because we were Muslims, but just because we are blacks. It says now you need a permit, and the permit was hard to get. So we thought of an idea. It says now we'll advertise the mosque. So Durban Corporation was taking out brochures for tourists, visitors. So we started putting a small advert in there. So visit the largest mosque in the southern hemisphere, this one across the road, for a free guided tour. My old number, original number, 27054. So the people phone mosque. They want to visit the mosque because they don't know the difference between a mosque and a temple. They think they'll come and see something nice and funny. You know, your monkey gods, your elephant gods, your snake gods, all the gods lined up. Like one English lady on a world tour, she was taken on a guided tour. And she said, I expected to find a funny oriental museum a la carte. Meaning the monkey god for Monday, an elephant god for Tuesday, and a snake god for Wednesday, all the gods lined up. But instead I found the truth. You know, that's what everybody expects. Because they don't know what is a mosque and what is a temple. They think it's another word for a temple. So people started coming along. And they used to go to the Durban Corporation to say, where to find the mosque? How do we get to the mosque? So they're very ingenious people. They said, well, everybody's asking about the mosque. The mosque is a look, we'll put the mosque on our tours. So they created what they call T8, Oriental Tour. They call it the Oriental Tour. The first port of call is the mosque. From here they used to go to the Indian market. From there they take them to Westwood Hotel. They have tea and cakes and they show them the Indian area. Then they bring them down to the Grand Amgeni River and end off in the Hindu temple in Amgeni Road. That is called the Oriental Tour. And more people, because it's cheap, it's quick, and it's around town, more people took it. So it started, and now we handle thousands a year, thousands. Church groups, school groups, the Durban Corporation brings 3 busloads a week. And then people and anybody say, look, if you want to visit the mosque at prayer time, you'll be able to observe the Muslim at prayer as if by royal command performance, especially done for you, as is, you know. And it's quite an experience. Because everything the Muslim does, there's nothing new. The most of our tourists are Jews and Christians, the white people, from overseas as well as from South Africa, Jews and Christians. And we have a common denominator with the Jews and the Christians. We are so close, the Muslim, the Jew and the Christian. We claim a common origin to Father Abraham, all going back to Father Abraham. And in our religious practices also, there's so much in common, which we don't know. Very first thing, when you come along, is that please take off your shoes. It's a kind of inconvenience you're putting it to. So, you want to see something nice and funny, you go through the process, but you're not happy, you see, taking off the shoes. It's not a happy act. So we start a conversation, says, do you know why you take off your shoes? The answer is always no. Would you like to know? Nobody ever says he doesn't want to know. It's the nature of man, he wants to know why. So you remember when Moses was on Mount Sinai, God spoke to him and he said, draw not nigh hither, put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place where understandest is holy ground. See, in respect of that commandment, we Muslims, we take off our shoes. So no cause for arguments. So we are only doing what God commanded your prophets to do in your own books. We are doing that. Then before we go in for prayer, we make ablution. In other words, all the exposed parts of the body are being washed. The hands, the feet, the nostrils, the nape of the neck, gargling the mouth, brushing the teeth. This the Muslim does 5 times a day, every day of the year. No one who's particular with his prayers. Then purely from the hygienic point of view, no one is going to find fault with a person who washes himself 5 times a day. It's a good hygienic practice. So the visitors, they agree, it's a good hygienic practice. It also serves certain psychological purposes, meaning mentally it's preparing us for prayer. We are washing not because we are dirty. We are washing because now we're going to stand before our Lord. So psychologically, we are preparing ourselves for prayer. And thirdly, this is also another commandment given by God Almighty to the Holy Prophet Moses. In the book of Exodus, that is the second book of the Bible, it is written, and Moses and Aaron and their sons washed their hands and the feet thereat. When they went into the tent of the congregation, they washed as the Lord commanded Moses. So we Muslims are still fulfilling another biblical commandment. Though we haven't got the label of a Jew, nor yet that of a Christian, yet in all humility we claim that we are more Jewish than the Jews and more Christians than the Christians in this, that we are trying to follow in the footsteps of the prophets. Then in the actual prayer, we go through different postures, eventually going into prostration, with the forehead touching the earth. We say in that position, Subhana Rabbil A'la, Subhana Rabbil A'la, Subhana Rabbil A'la, which is in Arabic, which means glory to God in the highest, glory to God in the highest, glory to God in the highest. The highest part of man and woman goes down into the dust before his Lord and he praises unto the highest. And this is also biblical. This is how all the prophets prayed. And when I say all the prophets prayed, it sounds like a sweeping generalization. Because you haven't seen it, you haven't heard it, and I'm just telling you, all the prophets prayed, it's all, I said, it's all. I said, if you know your own book, the Holy Bible, you read in the Old Testament, it says, and Abraham fell on his face and prayed to God. And again, and Moses and Aaron fell on their faces and prayed to God. And again, and Joshua fell on his face and prayed to God. When we come to the New Testament, we read that towards the last days on earth, Jesus Christ, he went to the Garden of Gethsemane with his disciples. He said, wait and watch. Look out. I saw. The Jews were after his life. And he went a little further and fell on his face and prayed to God. So I'd like to know from you, how does a man fall on his face and pray? Except the way we Muslims do. But the modern gentleman is more worried about the creases on his trousers than humbling before God. He wants to sit tight on his chair, bench, pew, and he's telling God what to do. A little wonder God doesn't listen. So he's wondering whether God is deaf or whether he's dead. I say, neither deaf nor dead. There is a means of approach with the spiritual physicians of mankind. They showed us how to do the job. But we are too clever. We want to sit tight on our backside and telling him, ordering him what to do. See, he does not listening. So it becomes a kind of entertainment and an education. And then people ask us questions. He says, now, don't see me. Gods there, idols and images. So, we abhor these things in Islam. Very, very strict. no picturization, no statues, nothing at all. We worship the unseen God of the universe, exactly as the Bible says that God is spirit, and those that worship Him must worship Him in truth and in spirit, not in form, shape or size. Because the most beautiful mental picture we create of the Supreme Being is still a figment of our imagination, and we are not to worship our imagination. We worship the Father in heaven, without form, without shape, without size. So, this is an education, and it's a service we offer to people. Say, now look, you come along. Usually we tell them, like you said, now when your husband comes along, say, look, come on, about 12:30 any weekday. So we'll take you around to the mosque and you come back and have lunch. You'll enjoy our curry and rice as well as the experience. And answer your questions. Why this? Why that? Because we are the closest to the Jew and closest to the Christian. But the world doesn't know that. The Christians generally think that we are the Antichrist. You know, we are the enemies of Christ. But no Muslim is a Muslim if he doesn't believe in Jesus. I don't know whether you knew that. No Muslim is a Muslim. If you meet any Muslim...
Did you consider that Jesus was a prophet?
A mighty messenger of God. We say he was a mighty messenger. But he was the Messiah, translated Christ. He was born miraculously. He gave life to the dead by God's permission. And he healed those born blind and the lepers by God's permission. We are going together. The only parting of the way is when the Christian says that Jesus is the only begotten Son. Begotten, not made. This is what the English people say in the Catechism, the Anglican Catechism. Jesus is the only begotten Son. Begotten, not made. So we are asking the English people, I said, now look, what are you emphasizing? You said begotten, not made. What are you really trying to tell me? If you were a young man, I said, my son, no. And you won't take offense. Even if you're a young man instead of a young lady, I'll call you my son. And if our friendship develops further, I might visit you home one day and ask your mom, says, where's John, my son? I said, no, he's just gone to the shop, he's coming just now. And you return. My companion, who doesn't know our relationship, is asking, is he really your son? I said, no. You see, this young man, he loves me like a father, like a grandfather. And I call him a son. It's metaphorical. But instead I said, yes, he's my begotten son. The meaning changes. Actually, I'm swearing you. The worst swearing I can give you, I say, you're a bastard. You're not your father's child, you're mine. That's what you said. I said, what are you trying to emphasize? Begotten, not made. Not like Adam. Adam was made by God. Every dog, pig and donkey was made by God. Jesus is not like that. He was begotten, not made. So what are you trying to emphasize? Because begetting is an animal act. It belongs to the lower animal functions of sex. How can you attribute such a quality to God? So in good faith, we are at war over terminology. See, the terms that you use, say, what are you trying to tell me? Please explain. Begotten, not made. So in American, you know, when I was rhetorically putting this question, he said, it means sired by God. So what? He said, no, I didn't say that. You asked me what it means. It means sired by God. So how can God sire a son? He creates by his act of will. The Qur'an says so. I don't know whether you had a chance of looking at the Qur'an.
Yeah.
But I'd like to present you with a copy. You know, you shouldn't go empty-handed. You come here. The Qur'an, this volume here, it's 2,000 pages. This is the Qur'an. This is the Arabic text with English translation and commentary. Arabic text, don't worry about that, shouldn't mystify you. This is the translation and this is the commentary. But now, this vast volume of 2,000 pages, when will you wade through that? We are all involved in a rat race, we still haven't got the time, and everybody is crying for time. No time. So, nor am I expecting you, madam, that you should wade through that book. It's a formidable task. So what I would say is, go right at the back, to the index. And in the index, just browse through. What are you looking for? You want to know about God. The overwhelming theme of this book is God. If a book comes from God, it must speak about God. And when you read about God, you can't help agreeing with it. You know, you'll find that everything it says is just ditto. No? You want to know about marriage in Islam. And the M, marriage, the types of people that you can marry, those who you can't marry, you find logic, reasoning, that we are the closest to the Hindu, the other Indian. But we can't intermarry. We can't intermarry. We speak the same language, we have the same surnames, but if they are Hindus, we can't marry. But I can marry a Jewess and I can marry a Christian woman. Ah, I said, I know why. I said, why? I said, because we are white. I said, no, nothing to do with your color. I can marry a Bushman woman or a Hottentot woman or a Bantu woman who is a Christian, but I can't marry an Indian woman who is a Hindu.
That's because they believe in idols.
Right, right. Because now, if my wife is a Hindu lady, and if I give her religious freedom, my children are born, and they're observing the mother cringing before an idol, an image, burning a lamp, and you know, the gods of the Hindus, man gods, women gods, animal gods, all this, so my child is going to imbibe that. We are closest to you. There are certain doctrinal differences between us, but we can accommodate, we can understand each other. And we said, look man, this is, what are we asking you to do? We said, come, let us worship God, the Father in heaven, who is the real God. Not Jesus Christ, he was a mighty messenger of God, and all the prophets said, love them, respect them, revere them, follow them, but don't worship any one of them, not even Muhammad. So if I said, no, Jesus is not the Son of God, but Muhammad is, there's something different. You know, I said, now make you fish of one and follow the other. I said, look, Jesus didn't die for anybody's sins, but Muhammad died for your sins. That is something, making fish of one and follow the other. No. I said, nobody dies for anybody's sins. You carry your burden, I carry mine. Personal responsibility, Islam teaches. Personal responsibility. Nobody pays for the sins of others. Poor Adam and Eve, they made a mistake for which they paid the full price. They were kicked out of the garden. Is that not enough? But the loving Father in heaven, your child disobeyed. And you deprive him of ice cream or of pudding, is that not enough? Or you give him a spanking, is that not enough? No, says the Christian. Now God curses, one, kicked out of the garden. Number two, he curses Adam and Eve. He said, you Adam, from now on you must sweat for your bread. That's what we are sweating. And you woman, you must bear children in pain and suffering, labor. Is that enough? Christian says, no, still not enough. He says, now the sin is inherited. There are more than 5 billion people on earth, and each and every one is a child of Adam and Eve. So as such, we have inherited the sin of Adam, the original sin, and as such, everybody goes to hell. And there's nothing you can do about it. Nothing yourself you can do about that, to get rid of that lodestone. You can't remove that burden. You all go to hell. Unless you believe that Christ died for your sins. You are being punished for something you didn't do, and you are now being rewarded for something also you didn't do. The Muslim says, it's an amazing situation that you are made to pay for a thing for which you were not consulted. Like, Adam didn't ask your husband, he said, shall I eat the apple? Eve didn't ask you, he said, shall I eat the apple? He said, no. Then how can God hold you responsible? It's the most nonsensical idea on earth. You are being made responsible for something about which you were not consulted. Like, for example, an African comes along, he wants a job. Then I want a man. I ask him what he can do my gardening, everything, salary, everything, agreed. He says, start tomorrow. But I said, what's your name? He said, John Dingaan. I said, Dingaan? He said, I'm sir. Sir, yes, sir. I said, that Dingaan, that fellow at Blood River, you know, who killed Peter Tiff and great merits, what was he to you? So he's my great-grandfather. I said, yes. Sir, shall I get you some tea? I said, yes, my name's Amsar, I can get some tea, get some biscuits, and I pull out a knife, and I put it in. I kill him. I'm not afraid to hide, I'm not afraid to hide that. I own it, because I killed that one. So the Lord catches up with me, and I said, why did you kill the man? I said, you see, his great-grandfather killed my great-grandfather. So I killed him. You know, there's no law in any country in the world that can hang me for that. I killed you because your great-grandfather killed my great-grandfather. The whole world said, this guy's a lunatic. Right? You can't hang him for that. Send him for mental observation. You think God is a lunatic? But he's worse. That's what you're telling me, that for Adam, the sins of Adam and Eve, 5 billion people will go to hell. the 1,000 million Chinese will go to hell, the 1,000 million Hindus will go to hell, the 1,000 million Muslims will go to hell for what Adam and Eve did. He said, now for what you did, you get punished. I can understand. What I did, I get punished for it. I can understand. But for what Adam and Eve did, I was not consulted. How can God hold me responsible? It must be a lunatic. That is actually what you are telling me. So Major Yeats Brown, a Britisher, he wrote a book on the life of a Bengal lancer, the British soldiers. And in that somehow he comes across this. He says, no heathen tribe has ever conceived so grotesque an idea, a filthy, dirty, ugly idea, involving as it does the assumption that man was born with a hereditary stain upon him, and that this stain, for which he was not personally responsible, was to be atoned for, and that the creator of all things had to sacrifice his only begotten son to neutralize his mysterious curse. No heathen tribe has ever conceived such filthy, dirty, nonsensical idea. But this man who lands on the moon, he is the one who's invented it. You know, the man who's got the world in the palm of his hand, that's his idea. You know, the most nonsensical idea on earth, that Adam and Eve eat the apple and whole mankind goes to hell. Now this is not Islam. No, this is sensible religion. Adam and Eve, they paid the price, God forgave them, said the Quran. God forgave them. You and I are personally now responsible for our actions. What good you did? Exactly as the Bible says. The Bible says, the soul that sinneth, it shall die. The son shall not bear the iniquity of the father. The son. Father, Adam, whatever he did, you are not responsible. The son shall not bear the iniquity of the father. Neither shall the father bear the iniquity of the son. The righteousness of the righteous shall be upon him, and the wickedness of the wicked shall be upon him. But if the wicked will turn from all the sins that he has committed and do that which is lawful and right, he shall surely live, he shall not die. That is salvation. You good man, you do good deeds, you be rewarded. You evil man, you do evil, you be punished. Your father Adam will not be questioned. Said, look at your children in America, 25 million sodomites. You Adam, what the thing that you have brought into the world, 25 million gays. Will God question Adam? No. Will God question you about him eating the apple? No. But now, this is Christianity. So we are so close, we believe in Jesus as a mighty messenger of God, as a great miracle worker, as a great preacher. So love him, respect him, revere him, follow him. But don't worship him. That's our fight. Don't worship him. Worship God, the one that you worship, the Father in heaven. He is the real God. So we are so close, and yet you're so far.
Yes, because the basis of all Christianity and the basis of belief in eternal life is that Jesus Christ was the Son of God and he died for us. That is the whole basis of Christianity.
Programming. We all get programmed. You see, I said, now you read the Bible. She said, yes. In English. Said, yes. King James English. Queen's English, yes. I said, you see, now you're reading that Bible and you are understanding the exact opposite of what you are reading in your own language. So what do you mean? I said, if you are reading the Bible, thou shalt not commit adultery, you are understanding as if it's reading, thou shalt commit adultery. So what do you take us for? Lunatics or what? Zombies? I said, no, I prove it to you. I said, you see, when Jesus returned to that upper room, where they had the Last Supper, after his alleged crucifixion, he goes in and he wishes his disciples Shalom Aleichem in Hebrew, peace be unto you. And when he said peace be unto you, his disciples were terrified. So I'm asking, why were they terrified? Because when you meet your long lost master, your uncle, your grandfather, you know, the Arab and the Jew, they'll embrace one another and kiss one another. He said, being that, they're all petrified. Why?
They believed you were dead. They believed he was dead.
Right, exactly. Luke tells us that they were affrighted because they thought he was a spirit.
Yeah.
100%. No, 100% correct. They thought he was a spirit. So I'm asking, did he look like a spirit?
No.
No. Then why should they think the man is a spirit when he didn't look like one?
Because they didn't believe.
No. The reason is because the disciples of Jesus were not eyewitnesses or ear witnesses to the happenings. Because Mark chapter 14 verse 50, he tells us that at the most critical juncture in the life of Jesus, all his disciples forsook him and fled. That they were not there. So their knowledge was from hearsay. People said that he was hanged on the cross. People said that he'd given up the ghost. People said that he did not and buried for 3 days. A man with such a reputation, when you see, naturally you are terrified. That's the answer. It is that they had heard the man was dead and he was buried 3 days already. So now such a person you see, it is him, all right. So they are terrified. So Jesus says, behold my hands and my feet. Have a look at my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. I'm the same fellow man, damn fools, what are you afraid of me for? He said, handle me and see, for a spirit has no flesh and bones as you see me have. Is that what he said? A spirit means any spirit. So in English, if I said I've got flesh and bones, in that case I'm not a spirit, I'm not a ghost, I'm not a spook. Is that what it means in your language? If I said, look, because I've got flesh and bones, I'm not a spirit, I'm not a ghost, I'm not a spook. Is that what it means in your language? And in Zulu, same. In Afrikaans, same. In every language of the world, it means the same thing. A spirit has no flesh and bones. I said, why did he have to tell you that? This is an axiomatic truth. The Hindus believe it, the Christians believe it, the atheists believe it, the agnostics. Everybody said a spirit has no flesh and bones. If you told me that you saw the ghost of your grandfather, I'm not going to ask you, did you feel his bones? Huh? It's understood that it was something intangible, something. So why does he say a spirit has no flesh and bones? Because they are thinking he is a spirit. Why they are thinking he is a spirit? Because they were not eyewitnesses or your witnesses. So he says, handle me and see. And they felt him, says the Bible. And they believed not for joy. Means they wonder, what happened there? We thought he was dead and buried. Anticlimax to what they were expecting. So to convince them further that he's the same person, he said, have you here any meat, something to eat? And they gave him a piece of broiled fish and a honeycomb. And he took it and he ate in the very sight to prove what? That is a ghost? No, I'm the same fellow man. Damn fools, what are you afraid of me for? Now, Thomas was not there at this first meeting. So subsequently, the other disciples, they meet Thomas. Hey, you know our master was here with us, and he ate broiled fish and honeycomb. He says, no, man. He said, this is all fibs. If they told him they saw the ghost of Jesus, then he would have believed. But he said, no, it's a real Jesus, man, the same flesh and blood. So he said, except I put my finger into the print of the nails and put my hand into his side, I will not believe. What? That he is the same Jesus. That I will not believe. 8 days later, the disciples are in. Thomas is there and Jesus walks in. And he had heard, maybe from the other disciples, you know our friend Thomas, he was saying he wants to do this and he wants to do that. So he says, Thomas, reach hither thy finger and behold my hands and put your hand into my side and don't be faithless. Thomas is not a healer, I have been. You know, all the 10 disciples, Judas was not there, all the 10 are testifying that same Jesus, we had food with us, you know, same physical Jesus. And I was not prepared to believe. Now Jesus has come, put your finger into the print of the nails and put your hand into my side and don't be faithless. I said, my God, my Lord, what a bloody fool I have been. Now the Christians misunderstood that to mean that he recognized that Jesus is his God. It's an exclamation. You come here and for some reason you come and you go and you talk some business and somehow the special branch makes a raid here. And I don't know, what do you people want here, man? You know, we talk religion, we talk about God. And they see, find nothing. You say, you know, that young lady, you know, that English lady that came here, she told us that you're running a communist cell here. What a thing, Mrs. Campbell Smith. You come along again with a smiling face. I says, Mrs. Campbell Smith, my God, you know, what did I do to you to deserve this? I says, Mrs. Campbell Smith, my God, what have I done? Am I saying that you are my God? No. But now, the Western world is programmed into believing that any excuse make him into a God. That man, he was born in the table to a Jewish girl 2,000 years ago. That's agreed. If you were a nurse 2,000 years ago in this table, helping Mary when she's laboring, the helpless little creature with all the filth and the muck, you know, is just being born, and you're helping Mary, can you for one moment think that's your God?
No.
His mother and Joseph the carpenter must have helped to change his napkins. Was he thinking he's changing the napkin of his God? The barber came and circumcised him on the eighth day. That's the barber's job, you see. The barber held him by his little tooth, loosened the skin, put a bamboo splint and chipped it. Was he thinking he's circumcising his God? No. How does it come about? Look, when he went to school with the other children, did they think they were schooling with a God? No. When the Roman soldier punched him in the stomach, he said, come on, professor, who hit you? Did he think he was punching his God? That other Roman soldier who lanced him on the side with the spear, did he think he was lancing his God? No. When the disciples, they ate and drank and they moved with him, did they think they were moving with a God? No. How did it come about? Jeffrey Hunter, he played the part of Jesus in, I think, the Day of Triumph or the one of these films of Jesus. He acted, Jeffrey Hunter. Blonde hair and blue eyes and all that. Handsome young man. When for the scene they took him to Jerusalem to climb the Mount of Olives or what. When he came down after the shooting, he said, for the first time in my life, I realized how human Jesus was. Because when he climbed, he must have also been panting, he must also have been sweating. Because like this we are dreaming, he is like floating in the air. In Bethlehem, Nazareth, in Jerusalem, he's here, there, everywhere, like the Almighty God, he's, you know, like the invisible man. I says, no, this man, poor man, he had to move, you know, he had to sweat in the sun. So, programming. We all get programmed from childhood. The Hindu, say, is Rama is God, Krishna is God, Hanuman, the monkey God, Ganesh, the elephant-headed God. But he said, how can this be? He said, no, you don't understand, it's a mystery. Rama is God, he's the seventh incarnation of God. Krishna is the eighth incarnation of God. Buddha is the ninth incarnation of God. That's what the Hindu says. They believe in endless incarnation. God Almighty coming to earth again and again as a man. The Christian restricts him to one. He says, before Jesus, God did not incarnate. After Jesus, he will not incarnate. He is the only incarnation. Only time that God came into the world, he came in the form of Jesus Christ. Did Jesus say that? No. He said, my Father is greater than I. My Father is greater than all. He said, I can of my own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge. And my judgment is righteous, because I seek not my own will, but the will of him that sent me. That's his greatness. Whatever God commands him, he is on that same wavelength. That makes him great. But he says, my Father is greater than I. He said, I, of that day knoweth no man, no, not the angels, not the Son, but the Father in heaven. But you say, he is God. And what kind of a God is this? His knowledge is not like God. His power is not like God. He said, all power is given unto me. It's not mine. When did he say, I am God? When did he say, worship me? It's an amazing situation. 1,000,000,000 Christians of the world, they say he is God, almighty in human form. I said, look, if God became a man, then he's not God anymore. If you, Mrs. Campbell Smith, if you choose to become a cockroach, yeah, that's for the experiment, to see how it feels. And you start, and I crush you, that cockroach. Nobody can charge me for murder. No? It's a cockroach I killed. So, if God becomes a man, he's not God anymore. He's a man. That cockroach. You can kill him. It's finished. He says, what has happened to you? You're reading something in your book, the Bible, and you're understanding the exact opposite of what you're reading. In everything. The disciples of Jesus, they misunderstood him ever. John chapter 14, beginning. He says, I'm going to prepare a place for you. In my Father's house there are many mansions. If it was not so, I would have told you. And whither I go, ye know. And the way ye know. You know where I'm going, and you know how to get there. They say, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can you know the way? They misunderstood. He's talking about spiritual things. They think of geographical locations. Johannesburg, Bloemfontein, Nelson Strait. He's talking about spiritual matters. So they say, look, we don't know where you're going. To Johannesburg, Cape Town, where are you going? I don't know how to get there. So he said, I am the way, the truth and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Means the way to God is personified in me. Look at me. The truth of God is personified in me. Look at me. Real life is personified in me. Look at me. You follow me, you will go where I'm going. That's too heavy for them. So one of them says, look, he didn't say actually the words, he said, look, it's too heavy, man. Like the Zulu, oh, too heavy. Send that up, you know. He said, forget all this, what you're talking. Just show us God. And it suffices us. all these, what you're talking, fancy talks and all, I am the way, the truth, the life, what the hell are you talking about? Just show us God and it'll be sufficient for us. So Jesus says, Philip, you have been with me for so long. Why ask us that? Show us the Father. If you have seen me, you have seen the Father. They misunderstood again. He said, look, you as a Jew, you ought to know better than that. God is not seen at any time. No man can see God and live, says the Holy Bible. So what are you asking? You're going to see God with your physical eyes when you can't look at the sun. The creator of the sun, you're going to see with your naked eye? You'll be consumed. Why would you make such a serious? If you have seen me, means if you understood what I am, you would have understood what God is. So he said, no, he's his Father. How can he be his own Father? If you have seen me, you have seen the Father, that he's the Father. Is that what he says? If he's the Father, then how did his Father goes inside and comes out of his Son? How can he be his own Father? No, but misunderstanding after misunderstanding. He explains to them as he explains to little children, and they can't understand. So he said, are you even yet without understanding? Again and again, ye of little faith. Ye of little faith, how many times? You read it. Again and again, you have little faith, you faithless generation, or faithless and perverse generation. And when he's provoked further, he said, oh faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I be with you? I said, if he was a Japanese instead of a Jew, he would have committed that honorable harakiri, suicide. They gave him endless trouble, the disciples of Jesus. And now the whole Christian world has misunderstood each and every word he said. Programming. He said, we are also programmed. Everybody is programmed. But I said, now we must be big enough to say, let us see what is involved. How did we get this? We say, Muslims say he's a mighty messenger of God. He'll never speak a lie. Jesus. We say, he'll never speak a lie. If he is God, he must say so he's God. Because my salvation depends on that. It's unfair to me. Mm-hmm. You say, you deduce from this, he said, I am the Father of one. See, he said that. I'm asking, what is the context? What is the context? He said, I am the Father of one. That means he's the Father. That's what the Christian is understanding. He is Father and the one and the same thing. If you worship God or worship Jesus, the same. I and my Father are one. I said, that's John chapter 10 verse 30. It is there. Jesus said, I and my Father are one. So, I'm asking, what is the context? And believe me, 40 years, I'm asking this to learned Christians. You are a lay lady. I'm talking about the priests, bishops. I said, what is the context? Because when I said, look, where does he say I am God? Where does he say? He said, I am my Father one. I said, that is true, he said that. What is the context? And nobody knows the context. Believe me, in 40 years, I haven't come across a single learned Christian who can give me the context. I said, you know what is context? What you quoted is the text. John chapter 10 verse 30. I want the context, the text that goes with it, before or after. As if the English person doesn't know what context is. I said, the Reverend Dr. Morris from Canada, I was asking him. I said, you know what is context? I said, is this the text? I want the text that goes with it, context. So he said, do you know the context? I said, yes, of course I know the context. So what is the context? I said, you see, we start with verse 23. John chapter 10, this was verse 30, start with 23. It reads, and Jesus walked in Solomon's porch, in the temple of Jerusalem. He's alone. Then came the Jews around about him, and surrounded him, and said, how long does that make us to doubt? If thou be the Christ, tell us plainly. Then brandish a finger in his face, they want to pick up a fight. They didn't like his preaching, you hypocrites, you generation of vipers, you white and sepulchres. All that now, they got an opportunity, he's alone, said, give him a bashing, but now you got to raise yourself into a frenzy before you start bashing. So now they just want to do that exercise. If thou be the Christ, tell us plainly. You're talking ambiguously, man. So Jesus says, I told you, and they believe not. The works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me. It says, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Verse 27, verse 28. My Father which gave them me is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. Verse 29, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. Verse 30, I and my Father are one. That is the context. Meaning that once the person has accepted faith, God sees to it that the man remains in faith. And my sheep, my followers, they believe me and they follow me, and I give unto them eternal life, and they will not perish. My Father, if he gave them, he is greater than all. And no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. I, as a teacher, also see to it that they are being protected. I and my Father are one in this, to see that the person of faith remains in faith. Where does he say, I am the same omnipotence and I am the same omniscience as God? He's talking about, in this sense, you are making allegations, false charge against the man, so he's now defending himself. He says, no, my sheep I told you and you don't believe, but my sheep who follow me, they believe, and God will give them, will protect them, and I also see to it. So he said, I and my Father are one. Now the Jews were looking for trouble. They were looking for a fight. So they picked up stones against a stone. Verse 31. So Jesus says, many good works have I showed you from my Father. Verse 32. For which of those works do you stone me? So they say, for a good work we stone thee not, but for blasphemy. Because that thou being a man makest us a God. That is another false charge. First was you talking ambiguously. You're not putting forth your claim clear enough. Now, when he beat them on that, now they say, now you're claiming to be God. What does Jesus say? He said, is it not written in your law? That's the answer. Is it not written in your law? Law, Hebrew word is Torah in the Old Testament. Is it not written in your law? I said, ye are gods. He's quoting from the 87th Psalm, where God speaks to the Jews, says, behold, ye are gods. With a small g. Ye are gods, and all of you are the children of the Most High. Then in the book of Exodus, God speaks to Moses, and he says, behold, I will make you a god to Pharaoh, and Aaron thy brother shall be thy prophet. Meaning, what it means is, I make you a god, means you are my representative. When they tell you foot sack, they're telling me foot sack. You see, you are instead of me, you are going. And your Aaron will be your mouthpiece. He will speak, your prophet. And I'll make him a prophet, meaning he will be your mouthpiece. Right. So Jesus is saying, look, it's written in our language, in our book, that people are called gods. And you find no fault with that. Moses is a god. That's what the Bible says. You got a small g for him. But there's no such thing as a small g or a capital G in Greek or in Hebrew.
Yes, that's true.
You, your convenience, you just want to create impression that Jesus is God, so when you say he, him, you, am, I, the I is a capital in any case, but now he, him, you give him a capital letter. If Jesus said I am God, you would have given him a capital letter. But Moses, you give him a small letter, G. Then in the book of Corinthians, chapter 4, verse 4, Paul says that the devil is the God of this world. Is the God, Elohim, of this world. You give him a small g. I want to know why. He is the God. According to your system of giving capital letters and small letters, the calls for a capital letter. Why do you give him a small g? Why do you give Moses a small g? No. This is out of your own convenience. You want to make Jesus into a God, hook or by crook. So I said, now look, it's so simple and straightforward and clear-cut. But now, your salvation, you see, this is the whole thing. Your salvation depends upon that, right? So by hook or by crook, you've got to have the Jesus divinity, and you've got to have him killed. But I said, now when you look at it objectively, the man is not a god, sin is not inherited, number one. See, the Bible says, the soul that sinneth shall die. The Qur'an says, as you sow, so you will reap. Everybody. Your common sense tells you the same. What you do, you must pay for it. Your common sense tells you that. Sin is not inherited. Number two, Jesus is not God. And number three, he was not killed or crucified. Your book. He's telling you, I'm the same fellow man. Third day, Mary Magdalene goes to the tomb. She's wondering who's put the word of the stone. The stone. But when she goes there, she finds that the stone is removed and the winding sheet's inside. So she starts to cry, anticlimax, because she expected to find Jesus there.
She went to anoint his body.
So she starts to cry. Jesus was watching her from wherever he was, not from heaven, but from this earth. This tomb was a privately owned property belonging to Joseph Arimathea, one of his secret disciples. And around the tomb was his vegetable garden, and perhaps the gardener's quarters to look after the garden. he's there in that vicinity. He sees this woman, he knows who she is, and he knows why she is crying. So he comes up to her and he says, "Woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou?" I said, "Doesn't he know?" Why does he ask such a silly question? It's not a silly question. Actually, he's pulling her leg. He knows that she's looking for him and she's disappointed not finding him there. So now she's crying, so he says, "Woman," is pulling her leg, "why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou?" She, supposing him to be the gardener. That's what the book said. Supposing him to be the gardener. I said, resurrected brothers look like gardeners? That then your father, when he's resurrected, he looks like a gardener, and your father-in-law looks like a gardener, and your husband looks like a gardener, and your son looks like a gardener. Can you imagine you won't be able to make out the difference between your husband? Everybody says, "Look like a gardener." No. Why does she suppose he's a gardener? I said, because he's disguised as a gardener. Why is he disguised as a gardener? I said, because he's afraid of the Jews. He's escaped dead by the skin of his teeth. And the Jews, if they find out, they make doubly sure that they kill him. So, she's supposing him to be the gardener, says, "Sir, if you have taken him hence, tell me where have you laid him, to rest, to relax, to recuperate, so that I might take him away." The one woman, the superwoman, the American superwoman, carrying him, a corpse, and taking him away. Go and bury him as a wood at the grave. Carry him and where? Take him home, pickle him. What does she want to do with this rotten corpse, 3 days old? She's looking for a live person. She was about the only woman, besides Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus, who had seen the final rites being given to Jesus. If she had seen signs of life, she was not going to shout, "Say he's alive!" Because it took so many hours to give the burial wash, 100-pound weight of medicines around him, and all that, she's watching, and 3 days later, the third day, she comes along to treat him, to take him away, and maybe in a condition that he can take him away to a better resting place. That's what she's expecting. She's anticlimax. So she's supposing to the gardener, says, "Sir, if you have taken him hence, tell me where have you laid him, not it, that I alone, one person, might take him, not it, away." The joke has gone too far. So Jesus says, "Mary," that's a Janet. The way your husband says Janet is different from what I'm going to say Janet. See? And you're in the middle of the night in your full sleep, and he comes and knocks at the door, maybe all of a sudden he's come from Botswana, and he says, "Janet!" Without opening your eyes, you can go and go open the door for him, because it's your husband. But I can say the same word, "Janet!" You don't produce, "Who the hell is this? You know, who's there? Huh? Who? Who are you?" So he says, "Mary." When he said, "Mary," she recognized that this is Jesus. So she wants to grab him to pay respect. So he says, "Touch me not." I said, "Why not?" Is there a bundle of electricity, a dynamo, that if she touches him, she'll be electrocuted? No. I said, "Because it hurts. He's been through an ordeal." She says, "Touch me not, for I'm not yet ascended unto my Father." Can't she see the man is standing there beside her? What does he mean, "I'm not gone up in his ear"? In the language of the Jew, in the idiom of the Jew, he's saying, "I'm not dead yet, but go and say unto my brother that I ascend unto my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God." Every sentence, Pontius Pilate's wife sees a dream in which she was told no harm should come to this just man. When the trial is going on, she sends a note to her husband and says, "Look, no harm should come to this just man, because on account of him I've seen some dreams." Then, when they bring the news that they want his body, Pontius Pilate marveled that he was already dead. No man can die within 3 hours by crucifixion. But he was assured. He said, "Yeah, he is dead." He says, "All right, you can have the body." But he marveled. Why marveled? Because he knew no man can die within 3 hours. Because crucifixion was supposed to be a slow, lingering death. It was to be an object lesson for others. Not a merciful, easy way out, like firing shot, or drowning a man, or spearing a man. He dies too soon. No, they want this man to be an object lesson for others. Sometimes the victim of crucifixion survived the first day, sometimes 2 and 3 days. And it is on record that 5 and 6 days that people have been alive on the cross. It was supposed to be slow, lingering there, then the guys, you know, shouts and cries and moves and faints, and he comes up again after an hour or a day, half a day, and again, this is a, don't you do that. Don't you? It's an object lesson for others. Not for me. So, each and every word of the whole Bible story, I'm reading this same, not another version, the King James Version, and I see that he was not killed and he wasn't crucified.
Sir, I'm going to have to interrupt you, because I have another appointment.
I'm sorry, Janet. I'm sorry.
Yes. It's been extremely interesting and very, I feel very honored sitting and talking with you. Yes. Thank you very much for sharing.
That book is yours.
Thank you very much for that. I will look after it.
The index, see Jesus.
Yes.
His birth. Just check up, what does the book say? And you just can't help agreeing. It's 40.
Well, it is the start of Lent for us today.
Right.
I'm going to church tonight because it is Ash Wednesday.
Right.
So, yes, I will read it with him.
Jesus! No, start with Jesus. Subject Jesus. Then he said, now look, I can't help agreeing with this. Why? Then he says, no, because it's closest to your heart. Because the book says, at the birth of Jesus,
yes,
says, behold, just this one sentence, behold, the angel said, O Mary, who's Mary? Mother of Jesus.
Yes.
God has chosen thee and purified thee.
Yes.
Chosen thee above the women of all nations.
Yes.
The Quran is talking. Not the Bible. The Quran is talking. She's a woman chosen above the women of all nations. Take this man.
Thank you.
And next time when your hadith, you know, visiting you, says, come, let's go and visit the mosque and let's have some curry and rice. You'll enjoy.
I will. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you very much indeed.
Pray for me as
I will.
May God bless you.
And may God bless you as well. And I wish you well with your fasting.
Thank you.
I've left you that
right.
And my card. If ever you should need me,
inshallah,
I would be honored.
Inshallah. Thank you. Thank you, Heather.
Is it this way?
Yeah, either way.
Either way?
Yes.
Either way.
The lid, the same.
All right.
Either way.
Okay.
From Addis Ababa?
No.
Yes.
I'm came from Addis. So I'm visit South Africa. And I'm saying, inshallah, maybe I will meet Mr. Ahmed Deedat.
Yeah.
So last night I'm arriving here.
Yes.
And then today I'm walking until I'm reach here.
Allah.
So I'm asking somebody, he told me in the office here.
Yes.
Alhamdulillah, I'll meet you. Inshallah.
Original place for the Sahabas making migration.
Naam.
Your country.
Sah.
You gave refuge to the early Muslims.
Naam.
Aha,
Alhamdulillah.
Yes.
Yeah.
I think twice they made the hijrah to Abyssinia. Twice.
Naam.
The king was good. Nagash was good.
No, Nagash.
Yes.
So
okay. How's Islam in Ethiopia?
In Ethiopia, wallahi, now it is good. Before also, now it is good.
Yes.
Now it is good, alhamdulillah.
Yes.
All people know what is the meaning Islamic. He knows now very well. Before the Sharia, this Russia, Inter.
Right.
Now everybody knows very well, alhamdulillah.
Now the Christians, how are they?
He's fighting with Muslim also, the Christians.
Yes. But because you see now, I went to the Sudan.
Yes.
Next door to you.
Yeah.
And in the Sudan.
Yeah.
At question time, you see, all my lectures are followed by questions and answers.
No.
So at question time, one young man is asking me the question. He wants an answer.
Mm.
He says the Christians are coming and knocking at our doors.
Uh-huh.
Coming from America, coming from England, in the Khartoum, and they're knocking at our doors. And when we allow them to come inside, they're asking us the question that you believe in the Yawm al-Qiyamah? I said, yes.
Yes.
After judgment, Allah will put you into heaven or to hell, whichever you deserve. Do you believe in that? I said, yes, we believe in that. So now this heaven of yours, where will it be? On earth? Or in the skies. What does your Quran say?
Mm.
Not what you heard, what you think, what you imagine. So if you say it's on earth, you say, show me. If you say it's all in the skies somewhere, you say, show me. And he knows beforehand that you haven't got the answer. The bulk of the Muslims, you will not be able to supply the answer. What does the Quran say? At the back of your mind, you know. And it didn't worry you. Nobody is worried where the heaven will be or where hell will be. We know haq. Heaven is haq and hell is haq. But where?
Said no.
It didn't worry. You're not worried where? So that guy wants to ask you, what does your Quran say? So he'll get the reply from you to say, I don't know. Then he will say, I will show you what my Bible says. Now, you are duty bound to listen to him, out of courtesy, because he gave you the first chance. Tell me what your Quran says. And you couldn't show him, he said, look, I'll show you what my Bible says. That's a strategy of opening the Bible to you. So now they want to know from me what is the right answer. So I'm telling them that if the Christian was asking me that question, I would have to confess to the Christian that I'm ashamed of myself, I don't know. I'm a born Muslim. I'm 75 years old. In the eyes of the people, I'm a knowledgeable fellow. In the eyes of the people.
No.
I know my limitations. But in your eyes, I'm somebody who knows. I'm an alim. An allama without the title. You see, at the back of your mind, Mr. Deedat knows. You ought to know all this. So I'm confessing to the Christian, I don't know. I'm ashamed of myself. Born Muslim. But so saying, I said, now we must turn the tables. So I said, look, but I take it that you know your Bible. That means you're better than me. I don't know my Quran as I ought to know. But you know your Bible. He said, of course. I said, can I have a look? He'll be happy to give it to you. That's what he wants. So as soon as he gives me the Bible, I said, I open up for him the first book of the Bible called Genesis. Chapter 19, verse 30, and I said, read this. So he's going to look at it, and he smells a rat. He doesn't want to read it. I said, well, what's wrong? Isn't that the word of God? He said, yes, I want to hear you read. If he reads, what does he read? He reads about the prophet Lot, Lut alayhi salam. After the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah, he and his two daughters, they go and live in a cave, alone. And in the cave, the eldest daughter tells the younger, our father is old. There's not another man on earth who can come into us like in the manner of all the earth, what people do. There's nobody to do it to us. Come, let us make our father drink wine, khamar, and we'll lie with him and preserve the seed of our father. So they made the father drink wine, and the firstborn, the eldest daughter, went and had sex with the father. Next night she tells the youngest, look, yesternight I slept with my father. You do the same tonight. So they made the father drink that night also, and the younger went and slept with the father. Sex. And thus, both the daughters of Lot were with child by the father. So I want to know from you, the Christian, what is the moral of the story? What is the moral? What lesson? We tell our children fairy tales. Fairy tales, we tell them. Fables. What is the idea? The idea is that they're trying to teach a moral. Don't be like the greedy fox. When he couldn't get the grapes, he says, sour grapes. Huh? My child, don't be like that. Don't be like the greedy dog. He found a bone, with a bone in his mouth, is crossing a wooden bridge across the river, and he sees a reflection in the water, and he's thinking there's another dog with a bone in his mouth, so he's greedy for the other dog's bone, he says, boop! So he lost what he had. Don't be like that, my child. It's a moral. Fables with morals. No foxes jump for grapes. And no dog cross the bridge with a bone in his mouth. And we are just telling them this created story is to teach a moral. What's the moral of this? Come. I want to know, what is the moral of this story? What lesson your daughter learns from this? Your sister, what lesson does she learn? And if you're a blind mother, you see, she wants you to read the Bible to her, and you read this, and she wants to know, what is all this going on, my son? You explain to her. There's the daughter of the king, the father, night after night. Still Genesis, the first book of the Bible. Don't go far. Chapter 35 speaks about Reuben, the eldest son of Yaqub alayhi salam. Yaqub's son, Reuben. He goes and fucks his mother. That's all. And it says here, and Israel was told. The father was told, he said, you know, your son, fuck your wife. And he didn't say, puh, you bastard. What do you know that the whole world is full of prostitutes? Let me don't go and see anyone. Or somebody else's wife or daughter. Why my wife? Your mother, you bastard. What are you going to fuck your mother for? He didn't even speak of him. He didn't even say, shit, you bastard. What do you do a thing like that? Nothing. What's the moral? Come. I want you to tell me what's a moral. then still Genesis, the first book of the Bible, don't go far, man. There are 66 books here. You don't have to touch them. First book of the Bible. Judah, the father of the Jewish race, is going to Timnah to shear the sheep. He sees a woman sitting by the roadside. He didn't know that she was his daughter-in-law. So he goes up to her and says, allow me to come in unto thee. So she says, what will you give me? He says, I'll give you a kid from the flock, goat kid. He says, how do you know? How do I know that I'm going to get it? You might grind and go away. He says, I'm going to guarantee. So what guarantee do you want? He said, your signet, your ring, and your bracelet, and your star. So the woman gave it to her, and had intercourse with his daughter-in-law. And she became pregnant. Straight away, one hit, twins. This old man, one hit, he gave twins to his daughter-in-law. And they become the great-grandfathers of your God, Jesus. They are the great-grandfathers of your God, Jesus Christ. What is the moral of that? Father-in-law. Now with this shit, the Christian is getting converts. And you and I, with the Qur'an, we are not getting converts. I want to know why.
No.
I'm asking the Arabs, I want to know why. Come, I want you to explain me. How is it that we don't get converts and the Christian is getting converts? In the year 1900, Africa was 3% Christian.
3%?
That means for every 100, only 3 Christian.
The another one?
They were all Muslims and animists.
Okay.
Today, the Christians is 40% of Africa.
No.
40.
More than.
From 3% to 40%. Allah. And by the turn of the century, they want to make Africa a Christian continent. And they'll succeed. We are satisfied. I'm a Muslim. Egypt, we are Muslims. Algeria, Libya is 100% Muslim. It's a bloody rubbish, man.
Blood rubbish.
Lamu, opposite Mombasa,
no.
Is an island.
Yes, I know.
It was 100% Muslim. It was like a virtual Medina. When you hear the Azan, everybody closes the business and everybody moves. All go for Salah. Lamu.
Yeah.
Very happy, very proud people. We are Muslim, Alhamdulillah. No bars, no dancing, no gambling, nothing. Today, there are more bars in Lamu than any other place of a comparable size in Kenya. More bars.
No.
Why? Because across the waters was mainland Africa.
Yes.
You got the enemies there, you see the kafir, and some Christians there. So you are 100% Muslim. You were not worried about them. Now they turn the tables on you. More bars, more gambling dens on Lamu, and more prostitutes in Lamu than any other place of a comparative size in Kenya. So there's no guarantee.
Yes.
Even if you're 100%, what about the environment? See, the people are you become smug when you're 60% or 80%. Syria is 80% Sunni.
Sunni.
We are Sunnis.
Aye.
But 20% of the Alawites, they're ruling you. South Africa was 80% black.
80%.
Right.
Yes.
But that less than 20% were ruling you for 300 years. In Zimbabwe, southern Rhodesia, Smith declared a UDI with only 250,000. And for 12 years he kept the whole world at bay. Whole world, the whole of Africa said, you keep away. For 12 years he kept everybody at arm's length. So, numbers don't count, man. See, these guys, you get satisfied. Egypt, I'm telling the Egyptians. I say, you read the Quran? I said, yes.
No.
They said, they read the Quran. I say, you understand what you read? So he said, not like you Hindis. I'm a Hindi from India. We read the Quran without understanding. We just read. Alhamdulillah. But we don't know what is Alhamdulillah. We can read the Quran, whole Quran, half the Quran, but we don't know what it means. There's a system. Indonesia say, Malaysia say.
Yes.
East Africa say, West Africa say. Do we read the Quran? But we don't know what we're reading.
Yeah, no.
But you Arabs, you Egyptians, you understand what you read. He said, yes. So I said, Allah is telling you. He's telling us all. But since I don't understand, like somebody shouts in an Ethiopian language now, fire, fire, I'll just keep on talking to you. There's maybe somebody calling his friend. But you who understand the word, you look. His uncle, there's a smoke coming out there. Come, come, let's get out from here. Is there a way out? Because you understand the word. I don't understand. I'm from Mumbukman, I hear the words. Doesn't mean anything to me. So you understand, he said, yes. So Allah is telling you, Ya Ahlul Kitab, Ya Ahlul Kitab, La Taghlu Fi Dinikum. Do not go to extremes in your religion. I said, did you tell them that? He said, no. So Allah is telling you to tell them, Wala Taqulu Thalasa. Don't say Trinity. Intahu Khairul Lakum. This is, stop it, it'll be better for you. Innama Allahu Ilahun Wahid. For you, Allah is one Allah. It's not three in one. Did you tell them that?
No.
So Allah is telling you, لَكَدْ كَفَرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهُ الْمَسِيحُ بْنُ مَرْيَمُ. Anyone who says that Jesus Christ, the Son of Mary, is God, is making kufr. It's an act of blasphemy, treason against Allah. وَقَالَ الْمَسِيحُ. But Christ said, يَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ اُرْتُلُوا فِي إِسْرَائِيلَ لَعْبُدُ اللَّهُ وَشِبَ اللَّهُ رَبِّي وَرَبُّكُمْ, who is my Lord and your Lord. إِنَّهُ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ, whoever will associate anyone with Allah, فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ لِلْجَنَّةِ, Allah will make Jannah haram for them. وَمَأْوَاهُمْ نَارٌ, and the fire of hell will be their dwelling place. وَمَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ مِنْ أَنصَارٍ, and for the wrongdoers there will be no one to help. Did you tell them that? He says, no. So Allah is telling you, قُلْ, say, يَا أَحْلُ الْكِتَابِ تَعَالَوْ. I say, you understand تَعَالَوْ? He said, yes. What is تَعَالَوْ? Call. يَا أَحْلُ الْكِتَابِ, you أَحْلُ الْكِتَابِ? He says, no. Who is أَحْلُ الْكِتَابِ? It's the Jews and Christians. Yes. Allah is telling you, call him. تَعَالَوْ. إِلَىٰ كَلِمَةٍ سَوَائِمْ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ. That become the common terms as between us and you. Let us get onto a common platform. Are you calling them? He says, no. So I don't know why. You understand what Allah is telling you? He says, Ta'ala. He said, yes. So when Allah is telling you, call him. Like you working for me. I see through the window an old man there. I say, Yusuf, that man there. See that the old man there? Sir, so go and call him. So you say, Mr. Deedat, you got noor on your face. Your face is shining. You know, your beard is like silk. I say, hey, you, go and call that man and come. He said, Mr. Deedat, I can wash your feet and I can drink the water. I'm telling you, call that fellow. That's what we are doing. Allah is telling you, call that fellow. So you say, I'm going to read Subhanallah 10,000 times, I'm going to do Alhamdulillah 10,000 times, and I'm going to go for Hajj, and I'm going to go for Umrah, and I'm going to fast every other day of the year, Dawudi fast. Allah says, call that fellow. He said, Ya Allah, you, Subhanallah, you're so great. He said, call that fellow. I want to know why. So they said, you see, this Mubarak fellow is no good. Husni Mubarak, no good. He's stopping us. Sadat was no good. Nasser was no good. He was stopping us from doing dawah to the Christians. So I said, look, Mubarak is today. Sadat was yesterday, and Nasser was day before yesterday.
Yes, no.
But for 1,400 years, the Muslims are rulers of Egypt.
There.
Except for a few years, the French came, a few years, the British came. But overall, for 1,400 years, you are the masters of Egypt. There was no Mubarak, and no Sadat, and no Nasser.
No, no.
Who stopped you? Come, come, tell me, who stopped you? I want to know, for 1,400 years, who stopped you from doing dawah? So, when I returned from the Sudan, I wrote this book called Combat Kit. Combat Kit, how to give battle. And this book goes inside your Bible. Then you do the exercise. You see? This book here tells you on page 2,
yeah,
the exercise what you must do. On page 2 gives you the exercise. What you must do. Combat Kit instructions. But then you mark your Bible. Your Bible at home, you mark it. In your Ethiopian language.
Yes.
Mark
there
it.
Is.
Huh?
There is.
Yeah. Mm. So you mark it like this and you write down. Incest between father and daughter. Then you write incest between mother, son and mother. Then incest between father-in-law and daughter-in-law. Shh. And the next one. And the next one. market. So this is like the Christian Scud. This is the Scud missile of the Christian. Yes. We turn this into a patriot missile. How you turn it against him? By putting this book inside. You see? This book there, inside. This becomes your index for your Bible. Ethiopian Bible,
yes.
The English Bible. Have it ready. Then you call the guy who wants to fight you. To the good guy, you open the Quran and you speak about the birth of Jesus. وَإِسْقَالَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ يَا مَرْيَمُ. So behold, the angel said, O Mary, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَاكِ وَمُتَحَّرَكِ وَاصْطَفَاكِ عَلَى نِسَاءِ الْعَالَمِينَ. That Allah has chosen thee and purified thee, chosen thee above the women of all nations. يَا مَرْيَمُ إِلِي رَبِّكِ وَاسْجُدِ وَالْكَيْ مَا رَابِي. So O Mary, worship thy Lord devoutly, prostrate thyself and bow down and pray with those who bow down. ذَلِكَ مِنْ أَنْبَاءِ الْغَيْبِ نُوحِيهِ إِلَيْكَ. This is part of the titles of the things unseen, which will be given to thee, O Most High Inspiration. Talk, man, talk. Learn to open your mouth. Our cases are going by default because we are not talking. The Christian is talking. He's selling. And there is a saying that if you are selling something, there is a fool born every minute. Somebody will buy any bloody rubbish. You know that? Any bloody rubbish is very nice, very nice. Somebody is going to buy that. That Christian is selling. The most nonsensical religion on earth is getting converts. The filthiest, dirtiest religious book on earth. Pornography. Huh? Brother raping sister is here. Son raping 14 of his mothers. One of the sons of Dawud alayhi salam. You read that in the book, in my instruction book.
Here.
Yeah. Yes. Uh-huh. One of the sons of Dawud alayhi salam. The prophet David, the king David.
Yes.
When his father is gone somewhere, in the palace roof he puts up a tent. And he brings all his father's wives, 14, and makes them to sleep and fucks them all. 14, one by one, he fucks them all. Son fucking his mothers. That book, he's getting converts. Then you and I are not getting converts with the Quran.
No.
Because you're not talking. Our Nabi said, بَلِّغُ أَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةً. Deliver the message regarding me, even if it is one verse, one ayah. You know one fact? Go and deliver it. Allah will give you more. He'll add more. But you're not prepared to do that. You're satisfied. You're going to go to Jannah. That guy's going to go to hell. You think Allah will leave you? Are they not his creatures? They're all going to hell and you did nothing to save them. You didn't even open your mouth. Yes, my brother, I'm sorry, I'm lecturing to you. I should be listening to you.
No.
Yes. You must take other literature as well. They're all available.
Okay.
At the reception.
Marhaba.
You take them.
Okay, I will
free.
Take
it. They are free.
Okay. Already I have bought about 3 cassettes. I will add it another.
Right.
From down there.
Well, what subject did you choose?
Some Quran.
Right. Yeah, Huzaifi, yes.
Huzaifi.
Right. Hajj documentary.
Yeah, documentary. And this one. The another choose for me and then let me buy about 2-3.
Right. Now, have you seen the debate of mine with Swagat?
No.
You didn't see them yet?
Yeah.
This is present.
Inshallah.
Pray for me as I pray for
you. Marhaba. Marhaba. Inshallah. Assalamu alaikum. Maybe inshallah. We'll meet again. Inshallah. Bismillah al-Kareem. Assalamu alaikum.
And Whatever you can buy, you buy. They're very cheap. 15 rand.
Yeah, 50 rand.
You know how much is 50 rand? It's $3.
$3 or $4.
You can't buy a blanket for that price.
No, no, no.
So
I got in the newspaper, you sell it in 15.
The 15.
Yeah.
Maybe $3 each.
No.
It's cheap. It's very cheap.
No, no. Cheap. Okay, assalamu alaikum.
Now they decide to cleanse it. Like the same fellows are doing the same thing like the fellows did the 500-year-old mosque in India.
Right.
I don't know what is the Muslim community coming to. Wherever you look, where Islam are, Lebanon, Palestine, Bosnia, Kashmir, India, where are you? Name all the Muslim countries where they are in the same, they had it there. Iraq, Iran, all over. And our people are dying.
See, we haven't done our primary duty. The primary duty of the Muslim is to do dawah.
Yeah.
No Muslim has a right to remain anywhere in a minority situation. Says Osman, don't fold you off Nigeria. You know, when the British conquered, you see. He said, no Muslim has a right to remain anywhere in a minority situation unless he is there for dawah or for jihad. What are you doing here? What are you here for? To make good living, easy living. Am I right? That's what you are here for. You're not here, you are in a minority situation and you are here only for living. You are in Britain, you are only there for a living. In India, to survive there, you are in a minority situation. So you have no right to be in any position in a minority situation unless you are there for dawah or for jihad. Now that's the primary duty of the Muslim, is to do dawah. And I went to the Sudan just now, last year, and at question time, one of the students, university student, is asking me, he says, Mr. Deedat, the Christians are coming from England and America, and they are knocking at our doors in Khartoum. And when we allow them to come inside the house, they are asking us whether we believe in the Day of Judgment. I said, of course we do. Second question, he says, now, after judgment is established, either you get Jannah or Jahannam, according to your deserts. You believe in that?
Yeah, so we believe for Christianity.
So now that Jannah, where will it be? Will it be here on this earth or in the skies? What does your Qur'an say? Not what you think, what you heard. What does your Qur'an say? So if you said on earth, he said, show me from your Qur'an. If you say it will be in the skies, so show me. And he knows for a fact that 99% of our people will not be able to show anything in the Qur'an. You have your prejudice. And actually it didn't worry you. Where would that heaven be? Jahan hoga wahan. Jannat is haq and Jahannam is haq. Wherever it is, you're going to get it. But now it didn't worry you ke kaha hoga. So now this is his strategy of cornering you to say, what does your Qur'an say? So as soon as you say, look, I don't know, then he said, look, I will show you what my Bible says. Now you are duty bound, out of courtesy, to listen to you. That's the strategy of opening the Bible to you. He gave you the first chance to expound.
You couldn't tell him.
You couldn't. So now I will tell you. So, Mr. Deedat, what is the answer? Dr. Kareem, what is the answer? See, in my mind, you are a more knowledgeable fellow. In your mind, I am a more knowledgeable fellow. But now, if you were a Christian asking me that, I would have to confess to you, I'm telling my audience, that I'm ashamed of myself. I don't know. That's a fact. I don't know. I said, you see, I'm a born Muslim. I'm 75 years old. And in the eyes of the people, I'm a very knowledgeable fellow. But I don't know. I'm ashamed of myself. But now, so saying, I said, I must turn the tables.
Sorry.
We must turn the tables. This is as a literature.
This whole thing in English.
That's right.
Yeah.
We must turn the tables. So saying, I said, look, I don't know the Quran as I ought to know, but I take it you know your Bible. He said, of course, he's got one under his arm. That's a missionary. You see? I said, can I have a look at it? That is what he wants you to do.
to take his Bible and read it. Can I have a look at it?
Take it.
He'll happily give it to you. So I said, you open Genesis, first book of the Bible, chapter 19, verse 30, and give it back to him. I said, I want you to read this. So the guy's going to glance at it. He's trained not to follow your instructions, not to play the game according to your rules. He smells a rat. He wants to change the subject. He said, Dr. Kareem, you know. I said, wait, is that the book of God? He said, I want to hear you read. If he reads, what does he read? He reads about Hazrat Lut alayhi salam. After the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah, he goes and lives in the cave with his two daughters. Alone. Father and two daughters. In the cave, the eldest daughter has a brainwave. Said, look, our father is old, thanda ho gaya hai. And there is not another man who can come in unto us in the manner of all the earth. So let us make our father drink wine, and we will lie with him so that we may preserve the seed of our father. Bapka Bij, Bapka Nam. Baki rahe. So the first night they made the father drink wine, and the eldest daughter went and slept with the father. Had sex, intercourse with him. The next night she's telling the youngest, look, yesterday night I slept with my father. Now you we do the same tonight and you sleep with him, so that we may preserve the seed of our father. Thus, both the daughters of Lot were with child by the father. Incest. Right? If he read that, I said, now what is the moral of that? What's the moral? We tell our children fables, fairy tales, with an idea that we're going to imbibe some moral. The fox and the grapes, the wolf and the lamb, the dog and the shadow. These things didn't happen. No fox jumped for grapes. But we were telling our children. I was being told, and I believed it, that the fox was jumping for the grapes. And the dog did really see his shadow. I believed all that. Whatever I heard, I believed. But we know it's fairy tales, fables. It's a moral. So look, don't be like that greedy fox. When you can't get a thing, you say sour grapes. Don't be like that, my child. Don't be like that greedy dog. It found a bone, and with a bone in his mouth, it's crossing a wooden bridge, across the river, and he sees his reflection in the water, thinking there's another dog with a bone in his mouth. He's greedy for the other dog's bone, so he's a boo! And he lost what is in his mouth. Don't be like that. Don't be like that. That is the moral. What's the moral of this? Then still Genesis, the first book of the Bible, chapter 35, he speaks about Reuben, the eldest son of Yaqub alayhi salam. He goes and cohabits with his mother. And Israel, Yaqub alayhi salam was told. That's all. He said, and Israel was told. Finish. He didn't say, Puh! Salah, khabis, super, kahika. You know, he didn't even lose his temper. Then still Genesis, the first book of the Bible, chapter 38, verse 15, speaks about Judah, the father of the Jewish race. He sees his daughter-in-law sitting by the roadside, and he goes up.
You give me a talk on that, I think something like that. Who's giving me a talk like that with the invitation sent out? How to answer the Christian
belief. Right, from this Saturday. From this Saturday.
Oh, look, I am doubly parked here.
Right.
Right, I just can't pick up this.
Right. You are welcome.
Okay.
You are welcome to join the class. You do a practical exercise.
No, I've got something else. I'm busy with a graveyard plan.
Right. No, then the following Saturday, and the following Saturday, and the following Saturday. Allah. Every Saturday in Ramadan.
I'm going to see your offices around.
Yes, let me show you. I'm sorry.